Good afternoon, everyone. I, Ankit, on behalf of NEN and Vadhvani Foundation, would like to invite you all for this webinar and also introduce our expert, Mr. Sameer Goglani. With already 5 startups in his bag, Sameer has a lot more to his name. He co-founded Madhouse Media in 2004, India's first organized movie rentals company, which was acquired by 70mm in 2007. At the Morpheus, Sameer works with portfolio companies on things like strategy, product, sales, marketing, bootstrapping, and whatever takes a startup to shoot. Sameer is also an independent filmmaker with film festivals, movie to his credit. Before I hand over the floor to Sameer, a quick note to all our attendees. You will be on mute. You may ask questions by typing in the panel provided. Over to you, Sameer.
Okay. So, welcome everyone, you know, for joining the session. So I think, so recently I read this very nice tweet which said, you know, entrepreneurship is probably the hardest job in the world, right? So, and I truly believe that. So I think all of you guys have made a choice to take that as a job. So, I started a company in 2004 and ran till 2007. And even now, Morpheus, you know, we run like entrepreneurs, like a startup. So, you know, so we understand what does it take to really be an entrepreneur, especially, you know, in an ecosystem like India, which is still in its infancy and not as advanced as the one which we see in the Valley, right? So there's a lot of stuff which is still getting built in. So let's get started. So I think the topic of today was what is that investors or in particular Morpheus looks for in the entrepreneurs before deciding to work with them, right? And I think many of you guys may know about Morpheus, but just to give you a very quick background, we are a startup accelerator, which means that we work with startups at the most young stage, almost helping them take work. And we run a program, startup acceleration program, which happens once in 6 months. And in that program, we accept about 10-15 companies. And so what we do is we work with the startups for about 4 months, where we spend about 10 hours a week working with each team, and also we provide about 10 lakh rupees investment. So our investment is honestly a very small component of the value we bring to the table. I think the money probably enables teams to kind of, you know, it's like a scholarship for 10 months before you can figure out something significant. So I'm going to talk about, whatever I talk about is more or less stuff that we look for at Morpheus in startups. And, you know, just to give you a kind of a background, so a lot of the startup conventions, so I mean, if you think about startups, right, so the capital of startups in the world is Silicon Valley, right? Bay Area in US, California. And a large number of people who are also part of the Indian ecosystem are people who have been exposed to Silicon Valley by working over there. But almost all of us, if you are folks who read about startups and internet and investing and all this stuff online, chances are that 70-80% of the articles which you read are also being produced by folks in Silicon Valley, right? So a lot of stuff which is being done in Silicon Valley is a very common knowledge for Indian startup ecosystem. So while that is good, but you know, I think there's one disconnect. So you cannot apply that knowledge or the conventions or the methods of Silicon Valley directly into India, right? Silicon Valley is about 60 years into its startup. Since starting startups, India is hardly in 10 years, right? So we have a lot to learn. So one of the things which you have seen in Morpheus is that, I mean, the ecosystem in India still tries to follow some of the Valley systems, whereas what we really need is to figure out and adapt things which work for India while we are aware of what happens in the Valley. We kind of don't just copy it blindly, right? I'm going to talk about things which Morpheus looks for. So I think first up, you know, things which we don't care about, right? So these are sometimes we have seen, again, you know, these things matter a lot in some kind of investment, but we kind of have a disagreement with. We don't care, you know, how much education as the founders receive. For all we care, they could be just 12th pass or whatever, and you know what pedigree they have. So we don't care about what colleges they actually went to, right? We don't care about have these people worked in this domain or not. So if you're trying to build a search solution, we don't really expect you to you know, have that background. Or if you're trying to do something with email, you should not have it. It doesn't mean that you have to work with Gmail. In fact, like in this new batch, we have a guy who's trying to do something fundamental with email, and he used to sell insurance policies before that. Right? It doesn't matter to us, right? Again, it doesn't matter how much work experience you have, or even if you have any at all or not. We don't really care about age. You could be 20 or you could be 40. We have both extremes represented. We don't care about like male or female. We don't. So like another bias which we see reasonably often is that people are not very comfortable investing in husband-wife teams or brothers teams, you know, all that stuff. So for us, none of this matters, right? Another thing which we don't care about is, in fact, we have some reverse bias toward that is basically what are the trends of investment, right? So basically, if you look at majority of the investments which are happening around us, you know, all the money goes to the trending sector, right? So e-commerce, group deals, and now the you know, the car booking segment, right? We started with Ola Cabs, but now it's like everybody's like there are 12 companies already funded on that. So let's talk about what is that we do care about, right? So the first and foremost thing is tenacity, right? So doing a startup is hard anywhere, right? I mean, there's no doubt about that. But doing a startup in an ecosystem like India, which is still in the infancy, is probably 5 times harder than doing it in the Valley, right? So I was just reading this announcement today where there's a very popular payments company called Square, out of the Valley, which raised Series D, and they got Starbucks as a partner and an investor, right? Now, I think Square is hardly 2.5 years old, but the amount of scale they have been able to receive just within 2.5 years is phenomenal, right? So if you had the same team of Square, bring them to India and ask them to do the same thing in India, it might take them 10 years, 7 years, right? The reason for that is, you know, as a country, as an economy, we are still building our systems, right? So if you are a guy building a startup in India, you need a heavy, heavy, heavy dose of tenacity, because startups are something in which the effort keeps going in for a while before you see anything out of it, right? And that duration of how long we'll have to just keep putting your efforts in is going to be like 3, 4, 5 years, something like that. And on average in our portfolio, we see that it's about 1.5, 2 years before the company can start seeing some really significant signs of, okay, things are working out, right? So part of the, so basically here is what, you know, when we look at tenacity, right? So we look, first of all, we look for individuals who are tenacious in general, right? So basically these are people, like if they take up a task, you know, they would rather like die in the process then leave it alone, right? So if they take up something, they always give their best, right? They put the full effort in doing something, right? But unfortunately, doing startups is so hard that just the natural reserve of tenacity which an individual carries is not sufficient, right? Because there is so much hard things which you have to face that you could run out of it, right? So how do you figure out a continuous source of tenacity, right? That's where the passion comes in, right? So basically, so let's say you're trying to solve a problem out in a domain which you're really passionate about, right? So this is something for whatever reason you really care about, right? And you have faced the pain personally, so you want to figure out. So if you are solving a problem as a team, which you are passionate in that problem which you're passionate about, that passion about the problem becomes a continuous source of tenacity. So basically, you can keep getting new dose of tenacity by the fact that you're solving a problem, right? So let me give you an example. So in the batch 7 or 6 of Marcus, we had this company called Float. The two founders, Maha and Sikand, like we fell in love with them the day we met them. We really liked the guys, random backgrounds, One guy is a core techie, one guy is a design guy. He used to be an artist before, plays music, stuff like that, right? So really, really good team, right? Very capable. And they start building an iPhone app, which basically would give some location-based notification, right? So in the beginning, they were all very enthused. They built the app. You know, they released it on the iStore. Got about 100 downloads. Came to the demo day. But somewhere I was never able to feel that energy which was coming in, right? And I could see that these natural tenacious people are somewhere seem to be getting tired doing this thing, right? So if you're doing something which you're not really enjoying, you basically tend to get tired. Even your natural big reserve of capacity are slowly tend to wear down. So they did a demo day, and then they come back to us and say, you know, Samir, we're not enjoying this, right? I said, okay, so what should we do? So he said, hey, we are from entertainment background. I think we should think of doing something on entertainment. And I said, wow, that's a good idea. Why don't you guys think about some idea? So that process led to the creation of Radio Float. So these guys, they dumped their earlier application. They created something new, the field of music. Now, both of the founders have been like amateur musicians for 20 years. Right? So they sing, they play guitar, right? And all these 20 years, they've been musicians. They also knew that, you know, in India, music cannot be a career unless you are part of Bollywood, right? If you are a good musician, but you don't have any connection, you can't go to Bollywood, you know, like you can only play part-time. So you have to find a regular job because music will never make you money, and then you do this thing. So these guys had experienced that pain for themselves. So with Radio Float, they're solving the same pain. So they're giving a platform for independent musicians of India, right, to come out and put their songs on Radio Float. These guys basically put it out on the platform and connect the musician with the audience. So basically the first thing which they've done is they've launched the iPhone app, which went live about 3 weeks ago, and it's doing phenomenally well. It's only got 200 downloads, very, very active usage. So what I saw was basically suddenly the amount of energy which they were able to put in every day, right, and still be passionate about, you know, the very next day, was directly coming from the fact that these guys are passionate about all of their products. So they found something which they really cared about, right? And you know, within no time, basically, we distributed that trial version of the app. We also found investors who were also as music crazy as these guys were, right? So we found this group of people who are also passionate about music. Very quickly, around 30 lakh people was put in, and they've been able to build a team. There are 5 people now, right? So the first 6 months, these guys did something which they didn't care about. And the next 6 months, they did something which they really care about. And the difference is like almost 30 times in terms of how fast they're moving, right? So that's where the passion bit comes in. So this is a very, very strong theme across our portfolio as well as outside. I've seen that entrepreneurs or founders who are solving problems which they personally have experienced, the pain which they can feel, which they care about, you know, are going to be always create something original and really good as compared to somebody solving a problem just for an opportunity. So a lot of people, you know, are basically typically, you know, like starting companies like e-commerce or group just because, hey, it's a great opportunity, let me come and start, right? That's a wrong answer, right? You want to start a company because you care about it. And for all of you, if you are like, you should ask this question to yourself. In all honesty, how much do I care about this particular domain? Because when you are going to go through it, you're going to come, you're going to have a lot of near-death experiences while your startup journey is going on. And the only way to survive and not go back and take a job is basically passion and tenacity, right? So look for that. Third thing is founding team dynamics, right? So basically, so individually, each founder is maybe great, right? But what is also very important is the dynamics of the team, right? So basically, if there are two or three founders, you know, we try to get very deep into figuring out, you know, how long these guys have known each other, have they worked before, have they built stuff together before, you know, do they get along well, will they be able to settle down responsibility, like divide stuff and not have ego come in between where everybody wants to be a CEO, right? So we basically, that's another area which we really care about. You know, we tend to observe. So let me tell you how we look at all these things. So basically, the process which Morpheus follows, people go and fill up an application online, right? And the application has very, very less number of questions about the actual idea which you are going to do. Most of the questions are about the person or the team, individuals who are applying, and the team dynamics, right? So we read those applications and we try to assess these things, the passion, you know, and all the stuff. At the same time, so basically if you like, so if you get to the application process, we do a couple of calls with each team, and then based on that, we make a list of what, like this batch, last batch, we made a list of about 35 companies with whom we did something which we call like a live-in period, right? The live-in is basically like a live-in before you get married. So let's work together for 2 weeks, right? We'll spend 5 hours a week with you. Let's do that and then we'll see. So basically what we feel is that if you work with them for 2 weeks, like if I'm doing calls with the team, running emails, you know, I can sense the dynamics, I can sense the passion, I can sense the tenacity, right? That's a method which we deploy to really, you know, make these opinions about a company. I don't think it's possible to judge these things just based on an application form or a business plan or a 2-3 call. We need some time. Yeah. So basically, so that's the next thing. So we look at, you know, founding team dynamics. We look at the passion. The next one which you look for is problem solving skills, right? So if you look at life of an entrepreneur, you know, from the morning to the night, you know, all you got to do is solve problems, right? For example, like when I was trying to log into this webinar, suddenly I realized that the webinar ID which I had no longer works, right? And it's 10 minutes to the call. So one option is to panic, right? Another option is to think how to solve the problem. So I called Sneha, who's the organizer of for many, and I said, hey, this is what's happening. And you know, she was also pretty good. So she guided me through the solution to this problem, right? So basically problem solving, see, I think that's the probably one of the most fundamental skills which an entrepreneur needs. Like, hey, I'm trying to register a company, it's not working. The CA says it can't happen. Oh, it's a problem, how do you solve it? Hey, I want to hire somebody, but you know, I can't get enough good resume. Hey, it's another problem, how do you solve it, right? So people who enjoy taking on problems. So when you talk about problem, right, it's really something, you know, like it's kind of a thing which maybe you haven't seen that scenario before, but you have to like apply whatever knowledge and experience you have till today to kind of, you know, try to tackle that and figure out what's the way up, right? Sometimes you can solve it yourself, sometimes you have to ask for help, right? So problem solving skills. The next one is, you know, I'm going to spend some time on this. This is what we discovered, what we call a subconscious thinking, right? So had, you know, bear with me a little bit, it's a slightly longer story. So basically about a year and a half, 2 years ago, you know, while we were trying to start our sixth batch, we basically, you know, we were doing this regular exercise which you do between every two batches, that just analyze all the companies we worked with so far, figure out which are the ones who are, you know, like figure out which ones were right and which was the wrong decision, right? And see what we can learn so that we make better decisions in future. So when we looked at this set of people, right, so we had three categories of company. Number one, company which are doing like really, really well. Like some of them, you know, like Intuistive, Tractor, Red Quanta, you know, all of this. They're like on a high growth, successful trajectory. Second were companies which had basically just gone bust, right? So whatever reason, they just shut. And third were company which are kind of media performance. So they could go up and down. We don't know about that, right? So we said, okay, so why are the ones who are successful are able to achieve success, and why are the ones which are doing, right? So when we looked at that, you know, basically, and another thing, you know, obviously, in case of startups, you know, only thing which matters is the founder, right? Especially the kind of company we work with, you know, very, very early stage. So we looked at a founder, right? So we saw one difference. And that was the primary, right? What we saw was people who were successful, the individual founders seemed to produce 30 to 40 times additional output or results as compared to the people who are not doing well. And that's a big difference, 30 to 40 times. And then we looked closely at them, we found that these people are, everybody is from similar backgrounds, similar colleges, similar IQ, similar number of RKT. So why such a difference? Like that is, I mean, we were surprised. We said we made a wrong observation. And when we looked deeper, we found something, right? What we found was that all these people who were successful or doing well, basically behaved in a very particular manner. One, that is what, you know, I started calling the subconscious behavior. So basically, these guys work in a manner where dominant amount of time they are in this mode where the decisions and thoughts and ideas are coming from their gut, right? From their instinct, which is what, I mean, at least I start calling it subconscious. So basically, they are not rationalizing everything. They are not making a lot of calculations. They are not doing what I call the conscious thinking. And most of the stuff which they do is very subconscious, right? So that was very intriguing to me, right? So I want to go down and understand the behavior a little bit more. So what I found was, you know, the brain really has like two parts to it. Like one is the conscious part, which we basically use to make slow decisions. And one is the subconscious part, which is in the background, and we have no access to how it functions, right? But if you were to look at some of the simple things which we learned to do when we were so young, and actually analyze them, you know, all of them are such complex operations, right? Think about things like, you know, learning a language and then starting to speak, right? Or starting to look at people's faces and read their faces. Right, so all of these things we learn when we are very young, but basically, you know, and these are all very complex operations, but they are automatic to us, right? So we don't, like, for example, when I'm talking right now, I don't have to think and pick words, right? Which is what I will do probably if I try to speak a new language which I don't know very well, so I'll try to pick those words, right? And that's conscious, right? So we have this very, very strong subconscious brain, which is still in the background, you know. Another example is, you know, when I'm throwing a ball at somebody and catch it, right? That's a very really common thing, right? A lot of people, all of us have caught balls hundreds of times, when we were young and maybe even now, right? So if you think about an operation, what really happens is the moment I pull out my hand and I'm about to release the ball, your brain catches a ray of light from the ball to the eye, divides by the speed of light, to figure out the distance of the ball from the eye, right? And via that, it calculates the coordinates of the ball for it to release, right? And then when I release the ball, it repeats the same steps every few milliseconds, right? So every few milliseconds, it knows the coordinates of the ball, right? And then using those coordinates, it plots a possible path, or maybe two possible paths, on which the ball may travel while it's coming to you. Right, and basically then, you know, and based on that, is a projectile, is a parabola, is it coming from up to down, is coming straight, and based on that, you decide to, like, you know, should I catch it with one hand, two hands, should I jump forward, right? So all of this happens to all of us in a very natural manner, right? But if you look at it, it's a very complex set of equations being solved while you are performing an act which to you looks so simple. So basically, there is very, very fast, powerful subconscious brain, right, which if used properly can help us work much, much faster, right? So people are subconscious, use the subconscious brain, and they are a lot faster than other people. But hey, you know, being subconscious is just being an autopilot, right? So that doesn't mean that you'll be right. So you could make fast decisions, but all of your decisions could be wrong, and you could just at the wrong path, right? So how do you be subconscious and also start making the right decision, right? So this is where the second condition comes in, right? Second condition is you are a subconscious person, and you start working on an idea or a problem which you are very, very passionate about, or basically something which is already on the list of favorites for your subconscious. And so all of us build a set of things which we already care about, or we start caring about a lot as we go through life, right? So these are the set of things which our subconscious really likes, right? So if you find something which your subconscious really likes to do, and then you start doing it, you know, try to dedicate your life to that. So with every 1 hour you spend on that activity, right? Because this is one of the favorite things for your subconscious to do, when you spend that hour, the amount of data that gets uploaded to your brain is very, very high. So you tend to retain a lot of what you heard or you saw in that 1 hour, right? and it gets stored in such a way that whenever next time you need to use that data, it's very easily accessible. Right? Let's talk about example of, let's say, a footballer like Pele, right? So Pele is probably one of the best footballers of all time. You know, at the age of, let's say, 3 or 4, you know, it was discovered, you know, as an accident, and like he loves to play football, right? And it was also discovered that he seems to have some talent for football, right? What that means is that basically whenever Pele started playing football, for every hour of football he played, he was able to retain a lot of techniques and skills which are used to play football. And then when he played for another hour, he basically was better than the first hour because he was able to go back and use the data, right? So basically what happened, so Pele probably played football for like 30, 35, 40 years. Right? So all these 30 years, like 10 hours in the days a year, he probably played football, right? So by that, so with every day of football he played, he basically had more and more data in his head, right, to refer to, right? So after playing football for these 5, 10 years, right, he has so much data in his head. So whenever he looks at a formation, you know, let's say he's going with the ball forward and there are certain players are standing in a certain way, you know, automatically his subconscious brain is going to look at all previous situations and tell him like which way he should take the ball. Or if he's in front of the goal and he has to take, there are two people in, standing in front, like what kick should he use, right? Because what has happened is over this 5, 10, 15, 30 years, there's so much of data got uploaded to the subconscious brain that it's able to make really, really nice decisions. So if you are a subconscious person, you pick a thing that you love to do and you start dedicating your life to it, you will obviously make mistakes like everybody else in the beginning. But slowly and slowly, all that data of mistakes will start collecting in your subconscious and use threshold. And basically, your decision will not only be faster, but also become a lot accurate, right? So I don't know how much sense this concept is making you guys. It's like an abstract concept, but basically that's what we have seen. And you know, I'm trying to do a little bit more work on this. I have another podcast which is recorded on this topic, you know, which we'll send it to you guys separately to listen to, right? So the fundamental summary is people are subconscious are always going to be a lot more faster in decision making, right? But they can only become accurate if they work in a domain or a problem which they really care about. Because once they start doing that, the data starts to collect in their head as they continue to work on that domain. And once they have a certain threshold data, the accuracy which they can bring to the decision making is going to be far, far, far better than anybody else. I think the next thing you know, which we look at is basically ambition to create value. So basically, you know, so our focus, as you can see, you know, is typically only on the qualities of the individuals in the team, right? So a lot of times we work with companies where it seems like the first idea they're working on may not be the idea which can get very big, right? So we don't mind that, right? As long as the guy is very ambitious. So basically, if you are an ambitious person or ambitious team, and you're working on an idea which doesn't fulfill your ambition even 10%, the moment you realize that this idea has some limitations, we are so sure that you will figure out a way to break that wall, right? And expand that idea into something which can be really large, right? But you can only do that if you are very hungry, very ambitious to create value, right? If we sense that you are somebody who's going to be happy, you know, achieving certain amount of revenue, a certain amount of scale, a certain amount of fundraising, right? We're going to step back. And because it is impossible to predict even if your idea of today will work or not. Right? So it is very possible that what you're doing does not work. Right? For most people, that's what happens. First idea, an excuse to get started. Right? So for a person with low ambition, you know, the only reason to work was that idea because they were banking on that. Right? And the idea doesn't work. They sit and start waiting for another idea, right? But for the person who has their ambition, you know, for them, that's the thing. If this does not work, based on this learning, I'll find something else, right? So that's, you know, so those are some of the things which we care about a lot. And I don't know how we are doing on time. But, you know, I've kind of covered, you know, what we care about, what we not. Right. I mean, and also, you know, like just to give a few more examples, next time you have a team, you know, so we started a new batch just a week ago about new companies. So we had, there are a few teams which we were interested about, not able to make decisions. So like, so we found set of people where we could see that, hey, they functioned in a subconscious manner, and so they were very fast in doing what they were doing. They created a good quality product, right, which was around travel. And we were impressed with the product, we were impressed with the people, all of them were very, very good tech guys. But none of them had any passion whatsoever for travel. Right? So they could not be the customer of their own products. Right? So ultimately, end of the day, you know, we ended up dropping the team. Right? Similarly, we had another person which we were talking to, you know, who has a very, very impressive background, you know, worked with one of the top travel companies, played a lead role over there. And you know, has a lot of exposure to travel. Very nice guy. He was a star employee. Many worked for that company. You know, and done some really interesting stuff. So we went to the final stage, and when we were trying to offer, we sensed that the guy was carrying too much in the head, right? Hey, am I going to be able to get value out of this guy? I'm going to be able to is it a good idea? Should I give so much equity? Can I do this? So we had some of that even during our interactions in the living, but we gave that feedback to him and he said he'll work on it. But we sent the same thing while we were negotiating the final offer, right? So he had actually not said no at that time, he probably would have come around. But basically the moment we sensed certain amount of conscious thinking, he backed off. Right? So basically, you know, I mean, you need people who are, you know, naturally very tenacious people, you need people who are working on problems they care about, you need people who like to solve problems. You need people who are subconscious, you need people who are very high ambition to create value. So personally, we feel that if this combination is met, you know, you have a team which will end up potentially end up creating a good company over the next 5-10 years. That's it from my side.